Laura, thanks very much.
Okay.
Okay, so, hi everyone, I'm Brendan Murphy. I'm going to talk about DNA potentiation, the regenetics method, and the concept of self-evolution. I'm a certified potentiation facilitator through the Phoenix Center for Regenetics. So that's me. I'm also a certified K facilitator, but we probably won't have a lot of time to talk about that, mostly just focusing on the regenetics method. And the material in the presentation is based largely on the material in Sol Luckman's book, Potentiated DNA, as well as his other earlier book, Conscious Healing, and as well as my own book there on the left, The Grand Illusion. So basically, to give you a bit of background on what potentiation is and where the regenetic method comes from, American author Sol Luckman, in collaboration with his partner Lee. It's a sound-based shamanic form of systematized DNA activation and holing and evolutionary acceleration. But it's basically unique in the world of healing and transformation. The most important aspect of the DNA activation methodology is actually the human voice as it chants a particular series of vowel sequences over the background hum of a solfeggio fork, or forks for the latter three activations. So the fork being struck at the beginning of each vowel sequence. And the reason we have the regenetics method at all is going back a number of years, Sol actually received a couple of vaccines in a short time frame, a narrow time frame, one after the other. They were actually for the purposes of overseas travel. And the result of that was a downward spiral into a dark night of the soul that lasted about a decade and completely destroyed his health. He spent 10 years trying to find a way to return himself to health, and he went through all the mainstream sort of approaches and all the alternative complementary approaches that he could find, and at the end of the day, none of them healed him, because none of them were actually capable of addressing the real issue, which was that his DNA had been damaged. His health got so bad that he spent most days just sleeping, and he became allergic to vegetables, like even things like broccoli and just common everyday stuff. I mean, that's how badly he messed up he was. So he really had a lot of work to do. It was through the regenetics method development that he actually healed himself and returned himself to health. So the purpose of the regenetics method is to target non-coding jumping or junk DNA, as it's commonly known. It's also to initiate healing by correcting distortions in the bioenergy blueprints. And it's not just about healing, it's actually about facilitating deliberate self-evolution and conscious personal mastery. And the key of the DNA potentiation phase, which is the first activation in the regenetics method, is 528 hertz vowel chant. So just a quote here from Dr. Len Horowitz, where he says, "In theory, phase locking your body to the 528 hertz frequency sends the most powerful healing energy in the universe to your DNA's amino acid sequence, which vibrates in a glycoprotein matrix of structured water and depends heavily on the 528 hertz frequency, not just for its physical structure, but also for its bioelectrical and bioacoustic functions." So the four foundational DNA activations of the regenetics method are: one, potentiation, which targets the physical and etheric bodies; two, articulation, which targets the mental body; three, elucidation, which targets the emotional body; and the fourth and final stage, which is transcension, which targets the spiritual or causal body. So as I said, the first stage, potentiation, the key ingredients are the vowel chant and your intention to heal and begin the process. So to do it, you need your puck of destiny and your 528 hertz solfeggio fork. And what you're going to do is you're going to take your fork and you're going to strike the puck. Then you do the vowel chants, and I'll show you exactly how the procedure goes in a minute. So this here is the vowel sequence that you actually use for potentiation if you're doing your own or for someone there with you in person. So if you look up the top line there at 1A, you'll see a vowel sequence there that's all in capital letters. And that's what you're going to chant. And so as I said, you strike the tuning fork and proceed to do the vowel chant, holding each vowel sound for approximately 1 second. And if you look below it, you'll see master 1B, and all those letters are in non-caps, lowercase. And while you're chanting the top line out loud, you're actually going to intone mentally the lower line there in lowercase. So you're silently doing that second line while you're doing the top line out loud. So that's the part where some people get a bit stuck sometimes, because it is challenging at first. You're doing two things at once, and with every vowel changing, every second, you kind of, it takes quite a bit of focused concentration to hang in there, especially early on. So I'll just grab my tuning fork and puck, and just give a quick demo of the top line to give you an idea of what it's actually going to be like. So here you can hear the tuning fork. And so what you do is you strike it, you breathe in for about a second, and then you start the chant. So it goes something along the lines of. Now see, it's too early in the morning. I've got to get in pitch. And you repeat each line three times before moving down to the next row. And that's basically how you go four times from top to bottom. You get to the bottom, two rings of the tuning fork, and then you work your way from the bottom back up to the top. And finish with three rings of the tuning fork. And basically let it ring out and sort of sit in your meditative state for a minute or two until you feel like you're ready to finish and complete it. But the whole process takes about between 20 and 30 minutes. So it can actually be quite demanding on the throat to keep that chant going for the whole time. So what this is doing is it's triggering a wave pulse of torsion energy from what this model refers to as the master field, which is where, as far as this model is concerned, the highest sort of aspect of self or highest subtle body resides. So, yeah, the higher self or superconscious or whatever you want to call it. So this energy descends through the chakra system, starting with a ninth vortex, which is actually not supposed to be there, up above the eighth transpersonal vortex. There is apparently a ninth one. So, and I'll talk a bit about that in a minute. So, as you can see, the energy actually spends 10 days in each center working its way through. And then as it completes the downwards motion, it takes a U-turn and heads back up again, spending a week in each center. And once it's done that, that ninth vortex actually descends over a process of 11 days, and it actually binds with the second chakra, the sacral chakra, which leaves you with an octave of eight primary energy vortexes there, the eighth one being the transpersonal one above the head. And so once that's completed, you then have this so-called charging phase where, again, the energy works down from top to bottom through the centers again, this time spending 17 days in each one. And so 42 weeks later, after potentiation, you've actually, the cycle has completed itself. So it's 9 months, and it's following a human gestational timeline. Obviously, one of the fundamental precepts behind the regenetics method is all illness, whether physiological or psychological, arises from bioenergetic distortions or disharmonies held in the bioenergy blueprint. And on the right, it's a depiction of the etheric body, or etheric double, from Barbara Brennan's book, Hands of Light. And I consider Barbara Brennan to be, you know, possibly the most reliable and informative source when it comes to the various subtle bodies and aspects of our being, because her vision is so powerful and so accurate, and she's one of those rare healers and clairvoyants who can actually see on basically every fundamental level of beingness. So she's a very, very interesting and informative source. And she makes an interesting comment that here, toning verbally, just using the sound of your own voice, the correct sound into a deformed chakra, the chakra takes the shape it's meant to have. So because her vision is so accurate, she can find the appropriate sound simply by watching the chakra respond to the variety of tones she makes. She says, when I hit the right note, the chakra simply stands up and spins correctly. It only takes a few seconds, once corrected on the etheric level, to become the correct color on the second emotional body level of the field. So she's been able to literally visually witness the power of sound as it works on a chakra. And so one of the questions that comes up for the Phoenix Center is, how does DNA relate to the body's bioenergy blueprint? So their response to that is, the latest research likens DNA to a biocomputer that holographically projects the human bioenergy blueprint, which in turn regulates cellular metabolism and replication. In an article called From Helix to Hologram, researchers Iona Miller and Richard Allen Miller write that life is fundamentally electromagnetic rather than chemical, the DNA blueprint functioning as a biohologram which serves as a guiding matrix for organizing physical form. And the Russian Garyev group, which we'll talk about a bit, has demonstrated that it is possible to use radio and light waves or sound combined with intention words to activate DNA, which then can modify the bioenergy blueprint. So this blueprint in turn is capable of changing how cells are made and function. This non-invasive approach has been called wave genetics, of which the regenetics method is a human potential-based application. So this is a stylized representation of the energy working its way down through the vortexes in the charging phase of potentiation. That's after the sealing of the second chakra has occurred through the descent of the ninth one. So this is the eightfold octave system here. And so another question that comes up is, what's the relationship between the bioenergy fields and the chakras? And the response given is that the chakra system here in this system is activated progressively, leading to increased energy output and availability. The chakras, which process torsion energy in the form of light, and bioenergy fields, which process hyperdimensional energy in the form of sound, form distinct bioenergy centers that give rise to the holographic interface underwriting the human body. Utilizing a genetic sound-light translation mechanism detailed in Conscious Healing and Potentiate Your DNA, each sonic field energizes the corresponding chakra, which then transfers bioenergy to specific aspects of the subtle anatomy. So I'll show you in a second the regenetics method timeline, and just quickly mention this, which states that the developments in this that occur in this process are designed to be supported by the individual's attention on and intention with regard to the transformational process of energetic consciousness expansion and integration that they refer to as conscious personal mastery. So each activation is done once and once only. And if you look at the top here, you'll see the timeline. I'm not going to read the whole page out, but just to look at the way that this unfolds. Again, you know, for some reason it follows a human gestational timeline of 9 months. So it starts with DNA potentiation, and the soonest you can get the second activation done is 5 months later. So if you do that, 4 months after that, you can then go through elucidation. And then following 9 months after that, you can then go through transcension. And then 9 months later, the timeline has completed itself and the process is complete. So three lots of nine. So sort of like giving birth to yourself three times over. So with potentiation, the first stage, ignoring the other three stages, here's a list of the most commonly reported benefits. And some of my own benefits from it have included quite a profound ligament repair in both shoulders, because I had damaged rotator cuffs going back to the age of 16. And it wasn't until I did my own potentiation that I actually experienced any kind of improvement in them, and it was a massive, massive improvement. And that improvement also gave me consistently better sleep, because I could actually sleep lying on my side without the usual pain and discomfort. I also had some apparent cartilage repair occur a little bit further down the track in my right knee. About 8 months after potentiation, I also had a spontaneous detox, which was nothing too severe, but the energy group one. See, there are three groups of people that come to this work, the Regenetics method, and you'll fall into one of three categories. I'm a category three energy group, and threes and twos tend to have apparently fairly mild, moderate detox responses. But if you're in group one, they have a tendency to have quite rapid responses and quite severe detoxes. So I had improved ligament repair mechanisms from that point onwards. After doing my potentiation, I noticed some improvements in food intolerances as well. And I've been very pleased to observe this year that I've had no hay fever symptoms at all, which is awesome. So another question that comes up sometimes is the issue of having your aura clear before doing a DNA activation. So the response to this question is basically, since DNA plays an important role in regulating the aura, morphic torsion field, not only does such a notion make little sense, it's impossible to clear the aura permanently without activating DNA. So while DNA activation might be facilitated by subsequently clearing the aura, effective DNA activation is the primary modality and is capable by itself of clearing the aura over time. So I need to mention the quantum SCIO electrophysiological scanning device here, because I'm going to show you some images taken, some before and after images. And the SCIO is a universal electrophysiological biofeedback system which coordinates an electromodal biofeedback program with computer software to gather bioenergetic information about the client's subconscious. The information is gathered from the body through electrodes in head and limb straps, providing an accurate and precise picture of the client's general status. This information is selected and listed by the SCIO in order of the highest reaction, and the stresses are analyzed in the course of a stress management session. But for our purposes here, what we want to see is what scans of people look like before potentiation and then during the Regenetics timeline. And so here's an image of the SCIO in action, rigged up to a laptop there. And so here's an image. Here's a SCIO image of an individual prior, or who has not had any DNA activations. They haven't touched the Regenetics method at all. And you notice that the colors are pretty washed out and weak. And also you'll see the four sort of black holes there, the energy distortions around the perimeter there. So this is someone who's had no DNA potentiation or any other activations. And gentlemen, kind enough to put the YouTube videos up from which I took these screenshots, is a guy by the name of Frank Nagy, and I want to thank Frank for letting us use these. So this image here is Frank's wife, taken 2 days after her articulation. So that's the second activation in the timeline. So she's 7 months into the Regenetics timeline now. And you can see, even though this is a different person, it's still quite instructive to look at it and note that the colours here are much more vital and bright. And there's a lot less energy distortion around the perimeters there. There's only one of these black spots. So this is 7 months into the timeline, 7 months after potentiation, and 2 days after the second activation. And the next image is of Frank himself. And this image comes from 1 day after elucidation. So that's the third activation. And you can see there's something drastically different here about this scan. He's at least 9 months into the Regenetics timeline by this point. And you notice that this sort of humanoid-shaped, auric field around the central body there, that's taking shape, which is quite striking. And obviously, the color scheme here is extremely different. And you notice there's none of these energy distortions and black spots around the edges. And it gets even more interesting in Frank's next scan, where you see this outline of the body has really sharpened up a lot around in the so-called auric field. It's clearly a sort of doppelganger of the physical form there. Again, the colors change dramatically, and there's no energy distortions whatsoever to be seen. No black spots at all. So here, Frank's 11 and a half months minimum into the Regenetics timeline. So 2.5 months after his third activation, elucidation. So what does a scan of someone who's completed the whole timeline actually look like? And unfortunately, don't have any images of that at the moment, but Frank will be uploading some more soon. I believe he's just embarked on transcension. So it won't be too long before he'll be putting up some very interesting scans, skio scans. And I myself wonder what a scan of me would look like, because I'm 4 months into transcension. So I don't think I'll find out, but it's an interesting question. I'm looking forward to Frank's next series of images. And if you go and look, if you actually go, you'll see the YouTube link here down the bottom. So you can go on YouTube and actually look at the videos from which I took these screenshots, and it'll give you a bit of a sense of three-dimensionality, because the image is actually rotating. It's obviously, you take a screenshot and you lose that effect. So it's important to come back to this idea of the fragmentary body, which we talked about earlier, with this second, the energy defect in the second chakra here, and the sealing of it through the descent of that ninth vortex up the top there, which comes down and binds with that second vortex. So fragmentary body is referred to as a consciousness vacuum. It's linked to shame, envy, embarrassment, and jealousy. So kind of an inferiority complex. Obviously, it blocks higher awareness. And it's also known to some people as the slavery yoke. So it's been linked. We've tied it into this phenomenon of people overdoing, overworking, and needing to be all and do all for others, even to the point where they run themselves into the ground. And you can see the slavery yoke, at work, all over the place with these people who are almost sort of everyday martyrs. They don't know how to say no to people, and they're always self-sacrificing and taking on more than they should, and shouldering more responsibility, more of the load than they really should, and even getting so much so that they get resentful about it. And as far as I and others are concerned, that's the slavery yoke or fragmentary body in action there. And on a physical level, it's also linked to dental bacteria and parasites, as well as etheric parasites. So again, the fragmentary body is sealed 5 months after potentiation has been done. So sealing the fragmentary body cuts off the energy to supply to etheric as well as physical parasites, making them more vulnerable to intervention or even expelling them outright. So in discussion with Sol, he said that he estimated he's seen at least 100 cases of etheric parasites being identified and or leaving after potentiation. Planetary parasites can be viewed using such devices as Harry Oldfield's PIP technology. And they come in various forms, many different forms. And I've accidentally left one of the parentheses off the end there, but one of the commonly identified parasites interfering with people's energy fields is actually the so-called grey alien. We won't mention the reptiles. So the transformed octave-based human bioenergy blueprint 5 months after potentiation, this is a stylized representation of that. Again, the eight primary vortices are there, and the fragmentary body has been sealed. So the system's balanced. The system's balanced and harmonious now. So getting this idea of non-coding DNA, another portion of non-coding regions of the genome is comprised of this so-called satellite DNA, which is variable number 10 on the repeating sequences. And microbiologist William Brown believes that through specific conformational arrangements, satellite DNA interfaces with the so-called morphic field. And I've added here that the morphic fields are the auric / torsion plasma fields. See chapter 9 of my book for a lot more information on this stuff, as well as the other chapters, obviously, which tie into it. Various shapes have specific resonances with the morphic fields and can therefore tune into different information programs. Since satellite DNA is very specific to each person, each of us tunes into a distinct and unique morphogenetic pattern. So bear with me here while I read through this wordy slide. It seems likely that both jumping DNA and satellite DNA interface with the morphic field and quantum vacuum, thus responding to alterations in one state of consciousness. Satellite DNA's ability to expand the number of repeating sequences means an increase in the information-carrying capacity of DNA. As a fractal antenna, DNA interacts with the vacuum, / ether, whatever you want to call it, transducing the zero-point energy which interacts with our consciousness. So, i.e., DNA is a consciousness antenna. The greater interaction between our DNA and the torsion scalar forces in the vacuum may therefore equate to expanded consciousness, while a lesser interactivity would result in a contracted awareness. So Brown states that certain modular arrangements of DNA would be more conducive to conscious awareness. So it's useful to come back and establish that there's apparently this linguistic connection to DNA. So Jeff Delro showed in 1990 that the four nucleotides of DNA inherently form fractal structures closely related to human speech patterns. In the 1990s, a team of Russian linguists led by biophysicist and molecular biologist Dr. Peter Gareth discovered that the genetic code in junk DNA follows uniform grammar and usage rules virtually identical to those of human language. And within non-coding and junk DNA segments, there are large numbers of endlessly repeated sequences with no apparent meaning, and even palindromes, which are words or sentences which can be read in either direction. So that would be a reference to the satellite DNA. And non-coding DNA's syntax, therefore, mirrors human language. So because the structures of DNA base pairs and of language are so similar, we can alter our own genetics by simply using words and sentences. So this is where we have a scientific basis for mind-body medicine. And one of the conclusions reached by the Gariev team is that the genome has a capacity for quasi-consciousness, so that DNA words produce and help in the recognition of semantically meaningful phrases. So this is era two mind-body medicine and epigenetics. So living DNA will always react to language-modulated laser rays and even to radio waves if the proper frequencies are used. And this was demonstrated by the Gariev group. So this finally and scientifically explains why affirmations, autogenous training, hypnosis, and the like can have such strong effects on humans and their bodies. And the Gariev group actually turned frog embryos into salamander embryos by electronically recording one species DNA information with laser light and then retransmitting it to the other species embryos and completely reprogramming them into a wholly different species. And they've cured human disease in using the same approach, basically. So the resulting salamanders were normal and could reproduce, which is pretty amazing. So we moved from era two medicine to era three medicine, and I'm going to expand on this a bit in a moment. If we look at Dr. Glenn Ryan's work, he demonstrated experimentally that anger, fear, and similar emotions have the power to contract a DNA molecule, compressing it, whereas emotions like joy, gratitude, and love unwind or decompress DNA so that the strands can be unwound for healing code access. Ryan's metagenetic winding unwinding effect on DNA samples could be created remotely, not locally. So my experiment using Russian healer Valery Sederin replicated the effect with Sederin stationed thousands of miles away in Russia. Ryan's experimental setup was in California. So this is a truly non-local effect here. So what we see is that while coherent electromagnetic heart energy does act locally within the body and also within a few feet around the body, there is also a non-electromagnetic torsion scalar component that acts non-locally via the vacuum ether. So ipso facto, DNA is a torsion antenna, a biological bridge between our space-time and the time-space ether. So what Ryan's research did was link torsion waves to the life-affirming emotions, such as love, which Luckman believes propels both our individual and collective evolution. So he says here that only the love-based emotions stimulate DNA to decompress so that messenger RNA can access codes for healing. Hatred, depression, boredom, and the like close DNA down on itself, severely limiting access to genetic information necessary for healing as well as evolution. So in Masuri Ryan's experiments, those with coherent electrocardiograms could wind or unwind foreign DNA samples at will, while those with incoherent heart energy could not. So in these experiments, simply feeling love-based emotions was not enough to affect the samples, which were in the same room nearby. But the intention to alter those samples actually had to be present. So feeling love-based emotions wasn't enough. It had to be combined with the intention to alter them. And it's interesting also that those DNA samples did not belong to the people involved in the experiment. They were foreign DNA samples, and yet they still responded to the intention. So I would expect that if they used samples from the subjects in the experiment, there might be an increased response because their DNA obviously would be more attuned to their own thought patterns, their own electromagnetic fields and torsion fields. So I've mentioned here that the Russians already knew that distant influence experiments on living systems worked. Their research into it goes back at least as far as the 60s, and I've elaborated on a lot of the Russian research in my book. So it's useful to come back to the DNA and the vacuum idea, and I couldn't resist putting a picture of a vacuum cleaner there. So in 1984-85, Garriott demonstrated in a lab that a DNA sample actually attracts and harnesses photons, causing them to spiral along the helix, which they continue to do even after the DNA is removed. And so that field effect was dubbed the DNA phantom. So what it shows is that the DNA phantom interacts with and entrains the vacuum or fabric of space, which is also referred to as ether or coilin. And if you read chapter 6 in my book, you'll see some really interesting information around that. So this is effectively saying the same thing as saying that the DNA phantom interacts with and couples with consciousness. So DNA can engineer spaced ether consciousness vacuum and entrain it, creating a scalar torsion field. Therefore, DNA is an antenna for consciousness. It is a torsion consciousness antenna. And it's worth noting that there is a two-way info-energetic path between the vacuum and DNA biology. So we can upload information to the vacuum, to our auric fields, torsion fields, and we can download information in the reverse direction. So it's a two-way street. So if we recap the idea of these different eras in medicine, which is a model that Dr. Larry Dulcie gives us, just briefly, era one was obviously the materialist era. Genetics, it's where we find the origins and foundations of allopathic medicine. It's a medical time, a paradigm of 17th century Cartesian mind-body dualism. So basically the attitude was spirit or mind stuff is distinct and separate from matter, and ne'er the twain shall meet, end of story. And that was that arrangement was arrived at by an agreement between Descartes and the church at the time. So there's a certain degree of irony in that if you look at the recent medical attitudes towards so-called alternative modalities. But anyway, this is an outdated mechanistic body as a machine, cut slash poison burn, drug vaccinate medical paradigm, which was brilliant for as far as repeat business is concerned for pharmaceutical companies. It's a reductionist mentality where the whole is simply the sum of the parts and no more. And feel free to note the ironic medical icon down the bottom right there. The icon or logo of mainstream medicine, the Caduceus. Thoroughly inappropriate. So the everyone comments the Darwinian theory of evolution and DNA primacy, which is the idea that genes control all bodily functions from the bottom up, and all modifications to the genome through the evolutionary process are entirely random errors, unintelligent and ultimately meaningless. So basically life is just this huge accident and somehow we managed to evolve from apes. It's a paradigm of genetic fatalism and disempowerment, which because it states basically we're all helpless victims of our genetics, heredity, and there's nothing we can do about it. So era two, epigenetics, showed that that's wrong. It demonstrates irrefutably that environment primarily dictates genetic expression, and it originates at least for the Western world, because this is a Western perspective, in the 19th century with the placebo effect. So the basic premise here now is that mind can influence the body, so mind-body medicine, within hypnosis, affirmations, and so on. So it's a paradigm of increased empowerment and personal responsibility. And it's the beginning of a return to holistic natural medicine, so Tai Chi, Qigong, acupuncture, stuff that in the East is, you know, just common sense. So epigenetics has shown us that our genes are constantly responding to various forms of environmental stimuli, including emotional distress, as well as movement, touch, mental activity, sleep cycles, and more. As well as many genes being involved in most changes of state, different genes are often involved in different time periods of that change of state. From second to second, genetic cascades are turned on or off by our experience, tells Dawson Church. And so if you want to get more into that, as well as the energy psychology therapies and psyche, you can jump on my website and download an article on that, which was just published in a recent Nexus magazine, the August-September edition. But that's downloadable on my website for free. So we then move into era three medicine from epigenetics into
Brandon,
metagenetics.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Can you go back to the last slide? You said that there's something available on your website. Maybe you want to just give people your website out now?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, it's just brendandmurphy.net.
Okay, so brendandmurphy.net.
Yeah, I'll show it again later on.
Okay, continue. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, so we go into era three, medicine, which is metagenetics now. So this is a total inversion of our sense of identity from the conventional era one reductionist viewpoint. The basic premise of era three is that consciousness is fundamentally non-local or transpersonal and the ground of all existence. So it's not merely an emergent property of the brain. Therefore, an individual mind can reach beyond the bodily confines to effect a remote healing or see faraway places, travel out of body, and so on and so forth. All this so-called paranormal phenomena, which is really not paranormal at all. So this paradigm of empowerment, accountability, and personal responsibility now challenges us to relinquish our victimhood and step into our power, our true identity as the creator, infinite, divine, God, whatever you want to call it, and see our human persona in a much larger context. So it's telling us that we are powerfully creative. Therefore, rest in peace, DNA primacy. So these are the three eras of medicine, just summed up in a table. I'm not going to dwell too much on it, but you can see the progression from left to right, from body to mind to spirit. And era three is now moving from thinking into feeling, from the head into the heart, from locality into non-locality, from personal ideas to transpersonal ideas. It taps into and acknowledges the superconscious or higher self. It's a Unitarian view and sound-based rather than light-based, targeting potential or non-coding DNA rather than proteins, cell membranes, and coding DNA. And if you put all the pieces together, you end up with a general worldview that is, for want of a better term, based on the idea of so-called intelligent design. There's just no way around that. So there's a few basic ideas that are important to sort of take note of for understanding remote potentiation, as well as remote healing in general. So basically, the vacuum ether unified consciousness field is holographic. This is where we get the whole and every part idea from. Distance is therefore meaningless, because every part is instantaneously connected to and reflects the information of every other part, at least latently. So this is where you get on the idea of non-locality from. So torsion scalar waves transmit information as opposed to electromagnetic energy at speeds that can far exceed the speed of light. So we're talking billions of times the speed of light even, because they're not carrying electromagnetic energy. They're transferring information through the ether. So torsion fields generated by the DNA of different people can be connected non-locally via the vacuum, which leads to information, instantaneous information exchange. And obviously that facilitates informational recoding of the target or the client, a patient, which facilitates remote healing. So that's partially how remote healing works. It's an informational recoding facilitated by the torsion fields coupling with DNA and being non-locally connected with one another. So to connect with or influence someone at a distance, obviously it sounds stupidly obvious, but intention is the key, and it's facilitated, particularly if you're trying to conduct a healing by being in heart-based coherence, by actually having heart coherence. So we have some pretty useful junk. The vast majority of DNA is not used in coding proteins and enzymes. That's why it's called non-coding. So as much as 99% of it is not used for that. So a large portion of this junk DNA is actually made up of mobile genetic elements, known as transposons and retrotransposons, commonly known as jumping DNA or jumping genes. So the transposons were discovered by Barbara McClintock in the early 40s, and they use a cut-and-paste mechanism to get around, whereas retrotransposons were discovered later on, and they use a copy-and-paste mechanism with RNA molecules acting as the intermediary and carrying the copying the code and carrying it off and inserting it elsewhere in the genome. So jumping genes can rewrite and activate or deactivate certain genetic codes and reportedly make up as much as half of the total DNA nucleotides. So it's not just useful junk, it's actually invaluable junk for evolution. So this quote is from Holly M. Dunsworth's book, Human Origins 101, where she states that the human genome has more non-coding DNA than any other animal known to date. And no one really knows why. At least half of the non-coding sequence is made up of recognizable repeated sequences, some of which were inserted by viruses in the past. These repeats may provide some genomic wiggle room. That is, long stretches of non-coding DNA provide a playground for evolution. It may be a huge selective advantage to have all that raw material available to mutate and either modify existing traits and behaviors or express new ones altogether. Humans are characterized by the ability to be flexible and to adapt quickly, so our junk DNA is potentially a priceless contribution to our humanness. And we could go one step further and say it's potentially a priceless contribution to our spirituality as humans. So can Kundalini or DNA modify the physical body? And we hear from microbiologist Dr. Colin Kelleher, who's studied non-coding DNA and transposons for many years, and he states that transposons are known to be engines of evolution. The most plausible mechanism for initiating a rapid, large-scale change in physical structure, even the emergence of a whole new species, is a simultaneous transposition burst. Similar mechanisms might also be involved in a Kundalini experience. There's more. So Sol Luckman actually argues in conscious healing, non-coding DNA through the regenetics method actually activates to build the Merkaba, meaning chariot or vehicle in Hebrew. So this is also known as the light body. And Kelleher adds that dramatic physical change could be described as the emergence of a new species in a single generation from humanity. I propose that a synchronized, non-random transposition burst is the most simple molecular mechanism to account for the required new configuration. I propose that a large increase in transposon activity under rare circumstances culminates in the generation of a new body, as in a light body, from the existing body. This final emergence requires a burst that results in the silencing of hundreds of genes and the activation of hundreds more. So here's a stylized representation of the Merkaba on the left, and you'll see that it's two interlaced tetrahedra, one pointing up, one pointing down, also known as the star tetrahedron. And on the right, bottom right, there is a July 2012 crop circle featuring a star tetrahedron, Merkaba. So, we hear from Dr. Amit Goswami now, where he states that the raising of Kundalini seems to unleash the dormant capacities of consciousness for making new representations of the etheric body onto the physical body. And he states that people in whom Kundalini has risen and been properly integrated undergo extraordinary bodily changes. For example, the development of nodules on the body that form the figure of a serpent. So one of the thoughts I would leave people with is that particular sound and light frequencies, as well as coherent heart-based intention, can be used as catalysts for dramatic biological and psycho-spiritual transformation. In a sense, the man or woman who completes the regenetics timeline can be compared to the butterfly emerging from its chrysalis, now equipped to take flight as the high self pours forth more of itself into the human persona or vessel than was previously possible. So this is a sound-based science of self-realization and self-evolution. And I've just tied in some of the ideas in the last few slides there into an article that was published in Nexus last year, which is also on my website there. There's a link just there. And it also ties in the concept of near-death experiences, because it's been put forth the idea that NDEs actually trigger Kundalini activation as well. So I put all that together in an updated version of that article on the website there that you can download for free if you're interested in any of this material. And I want to thank everyone for listening, and thanks for having me here, Thornton and Lydia and Gareth.
Well, thank you very much for giving this very elaborate, instructive, and very well explained presentation. I think you have a lot more to say. This was just the tip of the iceberg, let's say, so that there is obviously another dimension when you start to enter into this grand illusion. So we basically come to an end also of our event today. And whilst I really want to just encourage everybody to interact with us live, I think this is now the moment where everybody has reached a level of, let's say, over-absorption. We need to go back and look at the video to really get it all in. And I think the material was really, really well presented, and I'm looking forward to looking at it again once we're done with this. When I'm a little bit fresher, it's now 35 minutes past midnight.